This is Neil Jones, and for the Rock Show this evening, it is an absolute pleasure to be joined by the one and only Mr. Kip Winger. How are you, Kip, first of all?
Great. How are you, Neil? Thank you very much.
I'm very well, thanks. And listen, it's great to have you back with new Winger music, because you do all sorts of music. We'll talk about your solo stuff and your classical work as well, but it's time for a brand new Winger album. Album number 7, cunningly titled 7 as well. The last one, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, it's been almost a decade since the last Winger album. Is that fair to say?
2014, I mean, and really 15. So yeah, it's been 9 years since we released it.
And is that simply because, you know, you're all busy on other projects? Reb, of course, has been in and out of Whitesnake. You've been doing other music. Do you just come back to Winger, pick it up when the time is right?
In this case, yes. I mean, we were both very busy, and Reb was really busy with Whitesnake, and I was working on a musical that I'd written called Get Jack, which took 3 years, and then symphony work with Nashville Symphony. And so, yeah, I mean, and then now, so Reb got off tour, and we actually started this before COVID, and then that set us even further back. But we've been doing shows on and off the whole time. So, you know, we always play gigs. We would always play gigs on the off time, but now Reb is like full time back. So, and the timing all worked out. And so we, you know, finished the album. I don't know when, not actually that long ago. I mean, I finished it. And then we, you know, sent it right in and to the printer, basically.
And because you do musicals and because you do classical, does it involve getting into a certain headspace when you write them? Or do the riffs just come and you think, that's a Winger riff, I'm going to use that?
Well, Winger is very definitely Reb and me sitting down and writing songs, and it's the sound of his guitar playing and my voice. I mean, it would be impossible to do Winger without the sound of Reb's thing, you know. Mm-hmm. And so that helps a lot when you're sitting down and going, okay, well, we automatically have that, you know. And it's been the same way since the very first album. We sit down with a drum machine and he'll knock out a riff and we'll work from there. Rarely I'll knock out a riff. It's back and forth thing, but it's always, you know, Reb always has these very unique kind of special licks. So I just leave it up to him to come up with that. And then we build it all from there.
I mean, you are both, and in fact, the whole band are, you know, what you would describe as virtuoso musicians. And you've been called virtuoso musicians over the years. When you're writing a song, then, you know, given how dexterous you both are on your instruments, do you sometimes have to rein it back and think less can be more sometimes?
Yeah, sure. And we, you know, what happened with us is that we did a record called Winger 4, where I was really in the throes of this whole like learning explosion, and it was kind of like a composition exercise, and I think we took it too far for a lot of quote Winger fans, and they didn't initially get it, you know. And then we followed it up with Deal with the Devil, which was way more straightforward rock, and that album was very successful. So the thing, it's a very fine line when you're an artist and you have a quote brand, that you need to really stay on that, in that lane, but you want to make it new and fresh and different and evolve. And so those are the kind of equations that really are difficult when you have a situation like ours. For me as an artist, I can go out and do a solo album or a symphonic thing and be completely free, which I need that as an artist. So it feeds, coming back to Reb and me, one feeds the other. It gives me a lot of ideas to interject in the rock music.
Is Winger always the wife and the other stuff the mistress, or is it the other way around?
That's a great question. Oh my God. That's really funny. For a long time, Winger was the wife and the other was the mistress, but it has flipped before. It's right now, Winger is the wife. But You know, it's kind of in tandem. You know, I'm writing a violin concerto right now, so I have my keyboard in my hotel room, so I'm kind of doing all of it at once.
We'll officially call you a musical bigamist, Kip. That's probably the best way of describing it. Let's go. Let's go way, way back. I know that you guys, I mean, 35 years of Wingo. Correct me if I'm wrong, Bo Hill was instrumental, the producer in you meeting Reb. Is that right?
Yeah, Bo introduced me to Reb. There's a guitar player named Bobby Masano who was friends with Fiona. Bo was producing Fiona, and Bobby Masano recommended Reb to Fiona's bass player, Donnie Kisselback. And Reb came up to do some stuff with Fiona, and I met Reb, and Bo introduced me to him and suggested, you guys should write some songs.
And here we are 35 years later. And unlike a lot of bands, and I know that you do a lot of things like the cruises and you tour with a lot of bands, but there are some bands out there who are barely unrecognizable or barely recognizable from the originals. But you guys have got all the original members plus an additional member that kind of joined along the way as well. What do you think it is about Wingo that has managed to do what a lot of bands struggle to do, and that's just to keep those originals in place?
We're all friends. We've all been best friends. I mean, we enjoy hanging out with each other, and we look forward to, the hang.
Yeah.
We never got in any legal battles. We never got in any big fights. We all kind of see all of this the same, and we've never had any conflict.
Listen, let's also talk about touring. You're touring with Steel Panther, and I'm sure you've been asked this because obviously Steel Panther, massive in the UK. I remember seeing the guys when they were Metal Shop back in the Viper Room, and I was amazed just how big the band have got, certainly in Europe. But they are a sort of, they're amazing musicians, but they do, take a sort of, how should we say, a wry look back at the scene, don't they? But you were from that scene originally, so is that an unusual one for you to be on a bill with something which is done faithfully but done very tongue in cheek at the same time? What do you make of the whole thing?
I was the one who called Michael and said, let's do some shows together. That came from me. I texted him, said, let's do some shows. I'm a fan, and they're great guys and they're great musicians. So I think it's a special event for people in the UK to see the original thing and then to see Steel Panther. I think it's a really awesome juxtaposition. I think it'll be a very special thing for the audiences that you don't really get that much.
Yeah.
I'm excited about it. I have no problem. Like I say, it was my idea. So they loved it, and here we are. It's almost sold out too. So I mean, it's going to be a blast.
I mean, their popularity continues, and I'm sure Winger added to the bill has been responsible for a lot of those tickets being sold. Also, I just wanted to ask you, once you've done the Steel Panther tour, you're going to be out with Tom Kiefer from Cinderella. Do you go way back with Tom?
Yeah, we toured 6 months on the Long Cold Winter tour when our first record came out. And yeah, it was very successful tour and great memories from that tour. So Tom's great, and I love Cinderella. I mean, Tom's solo stuff is great, so we're doing a month. It's like a proper bus tour for a month in middle of, I think it's middle June 15th, I think it starts. And so yeah, we're really looking, and John Corabi's on that as well.
Amazing. And just talking about old days, you were mentioning the Long Cold Winter tour, but going back to the 80s, you got a big part of your career, a big part of the break in your career was, of course, being part of Alice Cooper's band in the mid 80s. When you look back on that period, fond memories, and are you still in touch with Alice?
Yeah, I just played with him in for Desmond Child's All-Star event at the theater in the Parthenon in Greece, where everybody played Desmond's hits, and I played two songs with Alice, and we hung out, and I mean, I don't golf, I probably should, but Yeah, we hung out. We're good friends. I played on the first Hollywood Vampires, yeah, I mean, I owe Alice Cooper a lot. I mean, he was a great mentor to me and a good friend.
It's funny when you say we all play Desmond Child's hits. I mean, that's a long set list. This is the man who said, "Don't bore us, get to the chorus," isn't it?
Yeah, Desmond's a bona fide genius, and that word gets given out way too much in our society. But I mean, and not only that, he's a beautiful human being. I mean, he's one of a kind, man. I was very lucky to be able to co-write the words on this Proud Desperado track with Desmond, and it was r amazing to witness what he does. I'd never written with him before. He's really incredible.
I mean, there were writers like him and Jim Vallance and Diane Warren who back in the late 80s were, the go-to songwriters. Was there ever label pressure for Winger to get songs from, that kind of stable at any point?
No, actually, there wasn't. I w always had pretty creative rein over the band. Maybe I should have, but I was never pressured to do anything like that.
You're no stranger to a good melody yourself, to be fair, Kip.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Well, listen, we'll play that new single. The album is called Seven, and you've got the dates with Steel Panther, which we'll give afterwards as well. But listen, just for now, just wanted to say thanks for letting us take you back down memory lane and to talk about all the projects that you've got underway as well. And we look forward to seeing you back on these shores before too long. Thanks for chatting to us, Kip.
Thank you. And by the way, you have a very rock and roll name. You put on a guitar and you're like
Hey, listen. I'm